greatest grudge fights in history. And now here is your host in our HBO studios in New York, Barry Tompkins.
Hello, everybody. I'm Barry Tompkins, and welcome to Boxing's Best. Over the next hour, we're going to be talking about grudge fights. Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier will join us right here on our HBO studios to talk about their three great fights. We'll talk about Lewis and Schmeling, Pep and Sadler, Graziano and Zale, and a whole lot more than that. With us is our resident boxing expert here at HBO, Larry Merchant. And Larry, let me ask you simply, what makes a grudge fight?
I suppose a broad definition would be that aside from the fact that the two men are trying to knock each other's heads off, they don't like each other. I'm brought back to my favorite grudge fight of all time in Philadelphia years ago when one bricklayer said to another bricklayer on the job, "You're a lousy bricklayer." A local club fight promoter heard about it, put them in the ring for four rounds, caused a sensation. Well, the grudge fights we're going to look at today are that kind of thing writ large.
You know, I have talked to countless professional fighters about that very thing. Do you really dislike the other guy? Do you have to build up an intense hate? They always say, no, I have a great deal of respect. I really like the guy a lot. And yet, that is obviously not true.
Well, there is always a mutual respect in the ring because nobody knows what the pain is of going through a prize fight except the fighters. But obviously, personal feelings do enter into it on many occasions. Ali and Frazier was a perfect example of a conflict in styles and personalities. It's a battle over turf, championships, neighborhood championships, whatever. It may be a battle over money. One guy's getting more money than the other guy, and the other guy doesn't like it. It could be almost anything like that. Roberto Duran, he made a grudge fight of every fight because he had to work himself up for that. I think we should remember that compared to other sports, any fight is a grudge fight.
Well, maybe the first big money grudge fight took place after World War I. Jack Dempsey was the champion. He had defended only five times, and he had to literally be talked into the ring with a promise of a $475,000 guarantee to fight a popular light heavyweight champion by the name of Gene Tunney.
September 23rd, 1926. After 3 years of idleness, Jack Dempsey defended his heavyweight crown against a tough ex-Marine named Gene Tunney. The 31-year-old Manasseh Mauler was in poor physical condition, having arrived for the fight sick to his stomach. Dempsey's handlers wanted the fight called off, but 120,000 fans gathered in Philadelphia to see Gene Tunney put an end to Dempsey's glorious reign.
Champion Jack Dempsey to the right has been after Gene Tunney relentlessly. Here in the 10th and final round, Gene continues to outspeed, outbox, and outmaneuver the ever-dangerous Manasseh Mauler. At the end of this final round, the slick-boxing Tunney takes a unanimous decision.
After the fight, Dempsey announced his retirement. Jack's manager, Gene Normeal, claimed his fighter was poisoned. Tunney called the charges trash. Then in 1927, Tex Rickard convinced Jack Dempsey to avenge his bitter loss. 1 year later, the most controversial battle in boxing history was about to unfold. The gate amounted to $2.6 million, with Tunney's share reaching $1 million. On September 22, 1927, over 100,000 fans at Soldiers Field in Chicago witnessed the legendary long count.
Dempsey opened up, catching Tunney with his potent right hand, followed by a series of seven devastating punches. Tunney goes down for the first time in his career. Dempsey stays near the fallen fighter. Referee Dave Barry waits for Jack to move to a neutral corner before he starts the count of one. Is Tunney dazed or wisely taking full advantage of those precious extra seconds to recover? Tunney gets on his bicycle, trying to stay away from the rampaging Dempsey. The Manasseh Mauler wants his title back. Dempsey throwing punches from all angles. Tunney backpedaling, trying to clear the cobweb.
After the fight, controversy raged over the long count. Some ringsiders counted Tunney on the canvas for 18 seconds. We may never know if Tunney could have risen in time. Jack Dempsey said he didn't think so. In round eight, Dempsey was dropped from an overhand right. He was a beaten fighter. At the age of 32, Jack Dempsey knew the time had come for him to retire. Tex Rickard tried to make a third Dempsey-Tunney match, but it wasn't to be. 9 years later, the newest sensation of the heavyweight division was Joe Louis. On June 19, 1936, an overconfident Louis faced former champion Max Schmeling. There were demonstrations by Jewish organizations claiming Schmeling represented Nazi Germany. As the world drifted into war, the boxing arena became a political battleground.
During the first three rounds, neither man got into serious trouble. Here in round four, it's still anybody's fight. A ripping right by Max Schmeling. Lewis is in trouble. Another dynamite right. Lewis goes down. Referee Arthur Donovan signals Max to go to a neutral corner. Joe's up on his feet, but it's all Max here in round four. Max kept pouring it on for the next eight rounds, and Joe was in trouble throughout. Joe is still on his feet here in the 12th round, but Max is all over the Brown Bomber. A ripping right to the jaw by Max Schmeling. Punches by Max. Joe is in desperate trouble here in the 12th. A dynamite right, and Lewis goes down.
The fight was stopped, and Joe Lewis had been beaten for the first time as a pro. 1 year later, Lewis went on to win the heavyweight title from James J. Braddock, but the loss to Schmeling still haunted him. 2 years later, heavyweight champion Joe Lewis signed to fight Max Schmeling. By this time, the world was at war, and word was spreading of concentration camps in Germany. Jewish committees threatened the promoter Jim Jacobs. Only when Jacobs convinced them that Joe would vindicate all of the gross conduct in Germany did the signing take place.
I'm going to be in the best of shape. And I'm sure they're going to be a very good fight. I'm happy that I have to chance again to fight for the title. And I hope the best man may win.
Even though both fighters tried to keep the fight in the ring, Max Schmeling's identification with Nazi Germany spearheaded an avalanche of abuse. Stories circulated with Max claiming he belonged to the superior race. Celebrated American heroes like Jack Dempsey were brought into spar with the former champion, but Max could not escape his heritage. Schmeling's trainer, Max Macken, was rumored to be strutting around the training camp in a Nazi uniform. Never before had a prize fight been caught in a political line of fire. The United States rallied around their worshipped heavyweight champion. Joe Lewis was invited to the White House, where President Roosevelt told him, "Joe, we're depending on those muscles for America." Promoter Jim Jacobs warned the Brown Bomber that if he didn't beat Max Schmeling, both of their careers were over. Joe received $350,000 for this, his fourth title defense. But clearly, money was of little consequence. Joe said he was scared he was going to kill Max in the ring. Joe Lewis was not only defending his heavyweight crown, he was protecting the values of American society. On June 22, 1938, 70,000 fans in Yankee Stadium and millions of people all over the world awaited a battle between two fighters and two ways of life.
This is the feature attraction, 15 rounds for the world's heavyweight championship, weighing 193, wearing purple trunks. Outstanding contender for heavyweight honors, the former heavyweight title holder, Max Schmeling. Weighing 198 and three quarters, wearing black trunks, the famous Detroit Brown Bomber, world's heavyweight champion, Joe Lewis.
The entire world is waiting for the result of this enormously publicized heavyweight championship fight. We're moments away from the opening bell. Joe Lewis, heavyweight champion of the world, comes out for round one in the dark trunks with the white stripe. Max Schmeling is wearing the all-dark trunks. Since winning the world heavyweight title, Joe has defended it three times. In his last defense of the title, 10 months ago, Joe KO'd Harry Thomas in the fifth round. Max Schmeling won the heavyweight championship of the world in June of 1930, 8 years ago from Jack Sharkey. Max was awarded the fight on a foul when he was hit low by a blow thrown by Sharkey. Schmeling lost a close, tough 15-round decision to Sharkey and lost the world heavyweight title 2 years later. Max is attempting to become the first former heavyweight champion ever to regain the precious title. Six other champions have tried and failed. Champion Joe Louis wants this victory desperately. Joe is deadly serious in there. An explosive right to the jaw hurts Max Schmeling. Joe Louis all over Max Schmeling here in round one. Ripping punches to the head. Joe steps back. A dynamite right to the jaw, and Schmeling goes down here in the first round. Max is up at the count of two. Louis moves in. Ripping punches by the Brown Bomber send Schmeling down again. A crushing right explodes off Schmeling's jaw, and Max goes down for the third time. It doesn't look like Schmeling's going to make it.
Joe Louis shocked the world with his first-round knockout of Max Schmeling. The Germans had cut the radio broadcast of the fight when Max began to go down. As the world drifted into World War II, Joe Louis had established himself as one of the greatest heavyweight champions of all time.
Joe Louis and Max Schmeling probably epitomizes the phrase grudge fight, but it was really much more, Larry, than just two guys who didn't particularly like each other in the ring.
Well, of course, Joe Louis had reason enough to want to destroy Schmeling. Schmeling had knocked him out in their previous fight. But there were extraneous events. Events domestically, we were in a depression, and events internationally, Hitler was menacing us and talking about a master race. And of course, Joe Louis became the focus of all American rage, and he took it out on Schmeling.
There, of course, was no nationalism involved in another great grudge fight series, and that was between Tony Zale and Rocky Graziano. These were two guys who truly didn't care much for each other within the confines of an 18-foot square ring, and they really had at each other in all three of their fights. Every one was a war.
June 10th, 1948. 26-year-old middleweight champion Rocky Graziano was favored in his heralded rubber match with 34-year-old Tony Zale. Each fighter had scored six-round knockouts in their first two meetings. This rivalry was as brutal as any in the history of the sport.
This is the third of a series of sensational fights between these two champions. Zale lands two crashing left hooks and sends Graziano to the canvas. This is typical of their two previous meetings. In that first fight, after taking a tremendous beating, champion Zale gathered himself and, in an unbelievable comeback, knocked out Rocky in the sixth round. But 10 months later, in their second fight, it was Zale who won the first five rounds handily. But suddenly, challenger Graziano came on with a tremendous attack to capture the middleweight championship of the world when the referee stepped in and stopped the fight. Round two was fairly even. Here, going into round three, the challenger Tony Zale seems like he has recaptured his youth, landing all types of smashing punches. He corners Graziano on the ropes, pounding away with both hands. He lands murderous combinations and gets Graziano in real trouble. With a right to the body, a smashing left to the jaw, he floors Graziano for the second time. And the champion, wearily, with the help of the ropes, drags himself to a standing position. Moves in, determined to finish it here in round three. He stays on top of Graziano, landing left and right hand uppercuts to the jaw. As Graziano staggers backwards, Zale advances confidently and with a tremendous right to the body and pulverizing left hook to the jaw, he knocks out Graziano.
Tony Zale had become the first man since Stanley Ketchel in 1908 to reclaim the middleweight title. It seems this startling knockout of Rocky Graziano was the only way to end a vicious rivalry between two gallant warriors. 2 years later, two featherweight champions, Willie Pep and Sandy Sadler, were involved in their own grueling confrontations. Each had won two previous title fights. And on September 8, 1950, over 38,000 fans arrived at Yankee Stadium in anticipation of yet another classic brawl.
Champion Willie Pep is wearing black trunks. Here in round three, Sadler has been tearing after Pep, which is the same tactic he used in their first two meetings, which the two men split. Willie goes down from a blistering left hook. Pep looks almost disgusted sitting there. Willie takes a count of eight before rising to continue. Sadler moves in after Pep. Here in round seven, Sadler continues to press Pep all over the ring. Pep's been boxing brilliantly, but Willie is definitely getting worn down from Sadler's battering.
Pep was unable to answer the bell for the eighth round, claiming something snapped in his left shoulder. After post-fight x-rays failed to show an injury, Sandy Sadler felt Willie was depriving him of a just victory. 1 year later, on September 26, 1951, Willie Pep and Sandy Sadler had their last chance to settle their controversy. Many people felt Willie Pep was now an aging 29-year-old as he attempted to become the division's first three-time champion.
Now watch the referee go down. Willie Pep in black is worn for wrestling tactics. Champion Sandy Sadler just seems too strong for Willie. Here in round nine, Pep's lightning speed is completely spent. Willie is terribly tired, just merely hanging on.
Once again, Willie Pep failed to answer the bell. The ex-champion told referee Ray Miller, "I can't go on." And so ended a legendary rivalry between two featherweights who shared the same era, Willie Pep and Sandy Sadler.
After that fight, Sandy Sadler was suspended and Willie Pep had his boxing license lifted for dirty tactics in the ring. Larry, I would have to say that Pep and Sadler might epitomize exactly what the subject of this show is.
They didn't like each other, that's for sure. And that came down to, I think, a matter of styles and perhaps the personality that fitted the styles. Willie Pep was a master boxer. He was a diminutive Muhammad Ali, moving much faster than Ali. Sadler was a tall, roughhouse brawler, and he was trying to slow Pep down. And every time they fought, it got rougher and rougher and rougher, and Pep showed that he had been a champion because he had that kind of roughness deep within him. He just didn't have to exhibit it before.
During that time that Pep and Sadler were banging each other around, a guy who many said was the greatest light heavyweight to ever come along tried to fill the very big shoes of the departed Joe Louis. Ezra Charles was the champion, and he had defended his title six times before stepping into the ring for the second time with an old man named Jersey Joe Walcott.
March 7th, 1951, Ezra Charles had won Joe Louis's vacated heavyweight title by defeating Jersey Joe Walcott in 1949. The champion was being criticized for fighting the 37-year-old Walcott. The challenger had lost three previous title fights, twice to Joe Louis, and was labeled a 6-1 underdog.
Jersey Joe Walcott, in white, is slightly behind on points, but Joe is always dangerous.
Jersey Joe Walcott did rise, but Ezra Charles won a hard-fought 15-round decision. The crowd actually booed the champion's performance and cheered for the aggressive 37-year-old challenger. After the fight, Walcott accused Charles of every dirty trick in the book. The champion showed a swollen right ear to the press, exclaiming that Walcott had used his laces to cause the damage. A rematch was inevitable. Just 4 months later, Jersey Joe Walcott was given one last chance to dethrone Ezra Charles. This was his fifth shot at the heavyweight title, and at the age of 37, it seemed an overwhelming task. July 18, 1951. Jersey Joe Walcott will remember that day forever.
This is the third contest between these two men, and although Charles won both times, each fight was a very close decision. Keep an eye on Walcott's left.
Charles collapses like a sack of grain after an incredibly well-timed punch explodes on his jaw. The champion struggles to rise. He's on his feet, but he stumbles backwards from the continuing effects of that devastating punch.
Jersey Joe Walcott had scored one of the most stunning upsets in ring history. At the age of 37, Walcott was the oldest fighter ever to win a heavyweight title. When the count reached 10, the new champion almost fainted from the excitement. Walcott recovered and said, "I've worked 21 years for this night. I prayed between every round. I asked God to help me." It was a bitter defeat for Ezra Charles, and the proudest moment in Jersey Joe Walcott's illustrious ring career. 14 months later, Jersey Joe Walcott was still the heavyweight champion, but he was the underdog in his title defense with Rocky Marciano. Walcott was given 40% of the purse, Rocky 20%, with the same provisions for a rematch should the champion lose.
In round one, champion Walcott in the white trunks comes right out bombing. Joe is a 2-1 underdog tonight, but the 38-year-old champion looks like he's out to end it fast. This is a new experience for Marciano. Usually it's The Rock who's dishing it out. Leading upsets is Walcott's specialty. Jersey Joe would like to finish off Marciano right here in round one. Walcott gets in with a left hook that floors Marciano. In slow motion, we can see how the champion timed that punch to perfection, shooting it right in with 200 pounds of weight behind it. Marciano is caught flush. His right hand too low to block Walcott's sizzling left hook. This is the first time Rocky has ever been down, but he has the presence of mind to take an eight count. Marciano knows that tonight he has a real war in his hands. There was no let-up in rounds 2 through 8, with both fighters throwing haymakers. Here in round 9, this excellent close-up shot shows you the fury of the face. Neither man is letting up for an instant. In rounds 10 through 12, Walcott had a decided edge, and he's definitely ahead on points. Now watch Rocky's right hand.
Walcott later said that as he threw his left jab, blood from his cut eye blurred his vision, and he was unable to see Rocky's crushing right hand. After the fight, Rocky received a hero's welcome from an adoring American public. But the new heavyweight champion was still bitter over the only knockdown of his career. Even though Rocky's purse would be smaller for a rematch, he was hungry for revenge. May 15, 1953, Rocky was upset over the imbalanced purse. $166,000 for the champion and $250,000 for a 39-year-old challenger. Many ringsiders felt that what transpired in Chicago Stadium was not even worth the price of admission.
It's round one. Walcott is boxing cautiously. Watch closely for a Marciano right. There it is. Walcott's down. Joe's taking the count. It's all over in round one.
There was tremendous controversy after the fight. Rocky Marciano commented that his right hand was better than the one I hit him with in the first fight. Walcott claimed he blacked out as the count went from 7 to 10. Whatever the case, Rocky Marciano was still the heavyweight champion and an idol of millions all over the world.
In 1956, Rocky Marciano retired as the undefeated heavyweight champion of the world. Larry, how good was Rocky Marciano?
Well, like Larry Holmes, he was good enough to beat everybody they put in front of him, and he didn't duck anyone. Unfortunately, his major fights were against fighters who were over the hill. Joe Walcott twice, Ezra Charles twice, Archie Moore once, and Charles and Moore were better light heavyweights than heavyweights. But he was a good fighter, a terrific fighter.
After Marciano had retired, that pretty much left the spotlight to a guy by the name of Ray Robinson, who almost single-handedly took care of all the lower weights. In 1957, at the age of 36, Robinson stepped into the ring as the middleweight title holder against a very tough customer from Utah by the name of Gene Fulmer. Fulmer came into that fight with a 37-3 record, and more importantly, had never so much as been knocked down.
January 2nd, 1957. Middleweight champion Sugar Ray Robinson took on a hungry 25-year-old native of Utah, Gene Fulmer. The challenger had never been knocked down, and he was upset over a 3-week postponement by Sugar Ray due to a virus. Sugar Ray Robinson was a boxer without peer in his era. He had captured the public's imagination, and he reaped the financial rewards. Sugar Ray would receive $140,000 for this battle with Gene Fulmer. He insisted on the challenger's take of $20,000. Fulmer was a very bitter man.
In round six, Robinson, in white, is involved in a rare rough-and-tumble title fight. Fulmer is throwing everything at Ray but the referee. Robinson is wrestled out of the ring. Referee Ruby Goldstein wipes Ray's glove. It looks as if Ray's in for a long, tough evening. Here in round 15, champion Robinson is tired and bloody. Fulmer's constant rough and bullying tactics have worn Ray completely down. At the end of the round, there's a new world middleweight champion.
Gene Fulmer had won by unanimous decision. Even though the experts gave the fight to Fulmer, many observers rode the crest of public sentiment and awaited the return of Sugar Ray Robinson. 4 months later, Gene Fulmer was made a 3-1 favorite to defeat Sugar Ray Robinson. No one had ever beaten Sugar Ray a second time, but at the age of 37, few people gave the ex-champion a chance in his quest to win the middleweight crown for the fourth time.
It's 4 months later. Robinson the challenger is in white trunks, and this is a classic bridge fight. Champion Gene Fulmer is ahead on points here in the fifth round. Left hook by Robinson. That crushing punch was delivered like a bolt of lightning. Fulmer is knocked out for the first time in his career.
When Gene Fulmer rose from the canvas, he wearily asked his manager why the fight was stopped. Robinson's picture-perfect left hook not only knocked the sense out of Fulmer, it also aroused a nation delirious over his celebrated comeback. In his locker room after the fight, welterweight champion Carmen Basilio challenged Sugar Ray for the title he had won for the fourth time. September 23rd, 1957, Sugar Ray demanded that Basilio surrender 5% of his purse. Sugar Ray went on strike for 9 days, insisting on a $255,000 TV guarantee. Basilio called Robinson an arrogant and greedy man.
Middleweight champion Ray Robinson, in white trunks, is after the smaller Basilio here in round 11. Robinson is throwing everything at Basilio as Ray pulls out all the stops, looking for a knockout. But Carmen comes right back bombing. Basilio has taken Ray's best shot and is now getting in there with his own big artillery. Carmen is coming on strong here in round 11. Ray looks helpless. Robinson is coming back. What a great round. Here in the 15th and final round, both men are all but spent. This has been an absolutely magnificent fight, and it's very close. Both men congratulate each other.
Carmen Basilio was given a split decision and proclaimed middleweight champion of the world. Immediately, there was talk of a rematch. Sugar Ray Robinson awaited the ultimate challenge. March 25th, 1958, Carmen Basilio was favored over a 37-year-old ex-champion trying to recapture the middleweight title for the fifth time. Sugar Ray Robinson was in store for the fight of his life, and 18,000 fans in Chicago Stadium were treated to one of the most memorable battles in boxing history.
Middleweight champion Carmen Basilio in black trunks has been pressing the fight, but here in round 10, Carmen's left eye is almost closed. Robinson wants that middleweight championship back for a record fifth time. sharp here in round 11. Ray knows he's ahead, and he wants to build on that lead. Champion Carmen Basilio can't see properly. Carmen's left eye has taken a terrible battering, but Basilio is still in there bombing. Both men looking for an opening. Between these two all-time greats, Robinson is putting on a dazzling display of punches. Basilio has never let up. Now Carmen's eye is completely shut, and he's in there fighting on courage alone. It's all Robinson here in the 15th and final round. Just look at Carmen's battered face. There's the end of this grueling championship fight.
Sugar Ray Robinson was awarded a split decision in a courageous performance by both fighters. Robinson was helped out of the arena, and Basilio was taken directly to the hospital. Sugar Ray Robinson accomplished what no man had before or since. He was middleweight champion of the world for the fifth time.
On December 10th, 1965, Sugar Ray Robinson hung up the gloves for the final time after 25 years and 201 professional fights. And Larry, I think it's safe to say he ducked no one, took no prisoners.
Well, he had a long-running series with Jake LaMotta when nobody else would fight Jake LaMotta even once. And I think his series with Basilio could be classified as a grudge fight, because Robinson, particularly late in his career, was a very tough negotiator. He'd call up the promoter a week before the fight and say, if I don't get more money, I'm not going through with the fight. They'd take it out of the other fighter's purse. So Basilio wasn't too pleased with Robinson's tactics there.
Was he, in your opinion, in fact, the greatest fighter pound for pound?
I think he has to be judged that. Let me put it this way. Roberto Duran, as great a lightweight as ever lived, when he moved up to welterweight, he couldn't knock anybody down, much less out. When Emil Griffith and Basilio moved up from welterweight to middleweight, they were still good fighters, but they weren't overpowering fighters. Robinson went from welterweight to middleweight, and we just saw he knocked a man out with one punch.
And while he ruled the middleweight division, a fellow by the name of Floyd Patterson ruled the heavyweight division. It was the first fight in 1959 since 1946 that had a $100 price on a ringside seat. It was the first of three grudge matches with Ingemar Johansson.
Heavyweight champion Floyd Patterson was a heavy favorite over Sweden's Ingemar Johansson. On June 26, 1959, before 22,000 fans in Yankee Stadium, the challenger pulled off one of the greatest upsets in heavyweight history.
Underdog challenger Ingemar Johansson paws awkwardly with his left, then shoots a sharp right to the chin of heavyweight champion Floyd Patterson. Patterson is down. He is hurt. Point out that Johansson used the same thunder right to take out Eddie Machen 7 months prior to this fight. That powerful right-hand punch didn't knock Patterson out, but it was the single blow that sent him ultimately to defeat. And European champion Johansson hits Patterson with everything. Patterson tries to fight back, tries to stay low and inside, tries desperately to hold on to his championship. But Johansson has the game, Floyd Patterson, and Johansson knows it.
Floyd Patterson was sent to the canvas 7 times, and the fight was stopped at 57 seconds of the third round. It was a brutal display of punishment, And shockingly, Ingemar Johansson was the new heavyweight champion of the world. Luckily, Floyd Patterson was guaranteed a 90-day return match from a clause in the contract. When promoter Bill Rosenson was put under investigation for faulty business practices, the second fight had to be postponed. 1 year later, with a new promoter, Irving Cohn, the fight was made. June 20th, 1960. Floyd Patterson was in the role of the underdog in a $2 million extravaganza. The soft-spoken Patterson resented the flamboyant Swedish champion and desperately wanted to regain his dignity and the heavyweight title.
Challenger Floyd Patterson takes on heavyweight champion Ingemar Johansson. Patterson goes to work early, working with sharp hooks to the body and the head. Johansson trying to measure his man with his lethal right hand, but Patterson constantly moves to his right, away from Johansson's payoff punch. Now it's Patterson with a sharp left hook, and Johansson is down. He's hurt. Referee Artie McCanty picks up the count. The champion Johansson here in round five tries to clear the cobwebs, but Patterson won't be denied. He remembers that Johansson knocked him out in three rounds in June of 1959. He wants to make history tonight. Patterson throws caution to the wind and pummels the big Swede with lefts and rights to the body and head, and then back to the body. Johansson is always dangerous, but is plainly hurt. He tries to hold on. Patterson is trying to coordinate his attack, waiting for the big opening. Patterson fakes to the body and lets go with a tremendous left hook. And if you look closely, Johansson's right foot quivers from the force of the blow.
Floyd Patterson became the first man in history to regain the heavyweight championship. Few people will ever forget the fury behind his punches. After such a humiliating defeat, this magnificent comeback was a courageous display of talent and pride.
After the last fight, there was some who said that Floyd Patterson was an overrated champion. Now, in view of last night's fight, does Floyd Patterson think that Johansson may have been an overrated champion?
Definitely not. I wouldn't say so. Even if he was, I would never say anything derogatory about any fighter, being a fighter myself. But I definitely don't think that he was overrated.
The punch that Floyd dropped Johansson with, the hardest punch he ever hit anybody with.
I can't answer that one because I would have to go around and answer all the guys that I hit.
Well, with me here in our HBO studios, a couple of very familiar faces in the sport of boxing. Muhammad Ali, of course, on my right, Joe Frazier on my left. And, you know, an interesting thing, before they could ever get at each other, early on in their careers, there were a couple of lumps that had to be taken. Muhammad, I refer, of course, to a fight back in 1963 in England against Henry Cooper, and you actually got knocked down in that fight. Do you recall the thoughts that you had at that time here? You worked so hard, you went through the Olympic Games, you had fairly easy time up to that point, and all of a sudden you're on your back.
I think I predicted around five for the fight. I did get Henry in five, but I suffered a knockdown in the fourth round. I tripped over a left hook.
What were the thoughts that went through your mind, if you recall, at that time?
Well, as I recall, I was stunned with a hard punch. I don't remember falling. I didn't remember getting hit. I just sat on my behind looking up. And I wasn't hurt, but I was dazed. And the first thing that came to my mind was I'd been hit and I had to get up. So immediately I got up.
Was that the first time you can remember really being hit?
Yes.
There was a conflict.
He hit me so hard, it jarred my kinfolks in Africa.
There was a conflict about that fight. I remember talking to Angelo Dundee about this. It had to do with a rip in the glove that Angelo will readily admit at this time that he actually made that rip a little bit bigger, and that gave you a chance kind of to catch your breath and give you another 30 or 40 seconds in the corner. Is that fact?
This is the first time I heard that.
Is that true? That did not happen?
Something happened to the glove. I think they took the glove off and sent to the back to get another one. I think that was the fight.
Gave you a chance, though, to at least catch your breath and get things back. And, of course, you made good on your prediction.
Yes.
And from there, of course, went on, and we all know what happened after that with Muhammad Ali. Joe Frazier also had a bit of a scare in a fight early on. I guess a guy named Oscar Bonavini, he was a tough guy, and at that time he hadn't been knocked down at all. He knocked you down.
Oscar was tough, there's no doubt about that. But let's say, being backed by a lot of business people in Philadelphia, I know once I got shook, I had to get up. There's no doubt about that. Let's say I had like 250 businessmen and invested a certain amount of money. I think it was one of your guys here who worked at the station, Larry Merchant, was one of the guys that invested some money. So therefore, at that time, when I got shook with Oscar, Oscar was a very good puncher, let's say as strong as a bull, and he didn't stop, and I didn't stop, and I got knocked down twice in that particular fight. And then one more push down, or whatever it may call, the fight would have been over. But knowing the people were standing behind me, I had to really put out that night.
All right, before we look down the road toward the good things, let's take a look back on a couple of the rocky moments of these two gentlemen, Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier. Let's watch Ali and Cooper, Frazier and Bonavina.
June 18th, 1963, the self-proclaimed uncrowned champion Cassius Clay invaded England and predicted a fifth-round knockout of Henry Cooper. Clay was a brash contender for Sonny Liston's crown, but in Wembley Stadium this night, his dreams were almost shattered.
You got to fight this boy Cooper. You've been playing around for a long time, sporting it, as you
yes,
say.
Yes, I'm not training too hard for this bum. Henry Cooper's nothing to me. If this bum go over five rounds, I won't return to the United States for 30 days.
Here in round four, the fight is quite even as Clay goes about his work almost casually. Cooper just keeps looking for that one clean shot. The count of four, a little wobbly.
After the fourth round knockdown, Angelo Dundee had discovered a tear in Clay's glove. As officials searched frantically for a spare, Clay was given time to recover. After escaping Cooper's left hook, Cassius Clay went on to beat Sonny Liston for the heavyweight title 8 months later. From then on, he became known as Muhammad Ali. May 21st, 1966, the fourth title defense of heavyweight champion Muhammad Ali. Henry Cooper was a 32-year-old hometown hero. At a pub near Cooper's training camp, his gloves for the first fight were hung proudly on the wall. A sign below read, "These gloves did not split." At 1:38 of the sixth round, Muhammad Ali had retained the heavyweight championship of the world. Finally, Ali had silenced the controversy of the cut glove. At the same time, a 1964 Olympic gold medalist named Smokin' Joe Frazier was an unbeaten heavyweight with his first real test. On September 21st, 1966, Argentinian Oscar Bonavena almost ended the title aspirations of a budding future champion.
Frazier goes down.
Joe Frazier managed a 10-round split decision. On March 4th, 1968, Joe won the world heavyweight title. In his second defense, Joe Frazier wanted only one man, Oscar Bonavena. December 10th, 1968, Oscar Bonavena stated that he had won their previous battle. The heavyweight champion wanted to erase the memory of the two knockdowns, and Joe said, if he's still standing, I'll keep smoking. Joe Frazier wanted to prove his supremacy.
Joe never lets up. He avenges the humiliation of those two previous knockdowns. It's all Joe Frazier.
Both of Oscar Bonavena's eyes were swollen shut, and heavyweight champion Joe Frazier was awarded a unanimous decision. But one fighter waited in the wings. In order to be recognized as the people's champion, Joe Frazier had to defeat one man, Muhammad Ali.
Well, why Muhammad Ali was inactive in 1968 and 1969, Joe Frazier won the heavyweight championship. He beat Jimmy Ellis, stablemate, oddly enough, of Muhammad Ali. But then Muhammad came back, had two fights, and we were ready for the first of three great ones. Muhammad, let me ask you first of all, what was your feeling about Joe Frazier, the man, at that time? I realized there was a lot of selling of tickets and all that kind of thing that had to be done, and which you've admitted was a part of the game. But what did you really think of Joe Frazier?
I love Joe Frazier. I can tell you now. I love Joe Frazier. I love Joe Frazier.
We have done so much
for each other, and we're making each other popular, making each other rich, done so much for boxing. I can plainly remember, I love Joe Frazier.
Yeah. Yeah.
I tell my bodyguards, I would say, y'all hold me to press conference. I'm going to pretend I'm going to jump on him. Uh-huh. Y'all hold me. I'm not going to jump on him. I ain't crazy.
Don't turn me loose.
He's a good street fighter.
Did you have to talk yourself into disliking him before getting into the ring with him?
I never disliked him. Tell me. I would never dislike even Cosell.
But why not?
Sometimes I just wish I was a dog, he's a tree.
But it wasn't until after the third fight, actually, that you finally said, I've got a lot of respect for Joe Frazier.
Well, when I first fought Frazier, I thought he wasn't as half as good as he was. I figured I could jab him, move him, and don't get hit. He hit me so hard, my toes trembled. He could hit.
Joe, let me ask you, what were your feelings going into the first fight? You had something to prove at that time, because everybody, in people's eyes, it was still Muhammad Ali who was the champion, even though you had the title.
Well, I imagine that would be one of the problems, that, you know, when he was stripped of the title, let's say because of the draft, you know, I didn't really have nothing to do with that. I think I was the only guy that fought for the championship maybe three times. You missed one guy, it was Mathis, too, before Jimmy Ellis. And I thought he was a great guy, and let's say, God bless him, Yank Durham told me, let's say, if you can get in shape and we can take on the champ, say, look, you got no problem, just go out there and be prepared to get the job done.
Muhammad, I want to ask you, going back to that first fight, in the 11th round of that first fight, I remember watching the fight and thinking, he's play-acting. He's not hurt as much as he appears to be hurt. Now, let me ask you point blank, were you hurt that much?
Yes, sir. But I have a way of getting hurt and putting emphasis on it to make the guys say, no, I'm not full of it. He's trying to trick me. I was really wanting to do that, but I did that. I put more in it. And by me, when he hit me, I said, oh, I'm in trouble.
So I stopped.
Let me ask, Joe, what were the thoughts that you had in the 15th round?
We still got to fight.
Right now? This is only for a dollar and a half here. You know what this? In the 15th round, what were the thoughts that went through your mind when you saw the man go down?
But what about, Governor, you missed all the rounds. 15 rounds? I heard him every rounds in that fight. Every round, two and three times, he got shook. I'll tell you, he got shook in that round. It was so, listen, I've seen time that when I was coming up as a boy and I used to work in the country, I used to hang the sacks on the trees, you know what I mean? I used to hit the sacks and the trees used to tremble. You know what I mean? So that's what he got cooked with, hit with that left hook. Every round he got shook. I keep saying, who he kidding? It ain't me, because I've been hitting him. I know I shook him.
All right, let's go back and look at it. It happened at Madison Square Garden. 20,000 people on hand for the first of three great fights and millions more on close
circuit. Who's your freezer?
Let's watch it.
March 8th, 1971. Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier were each guaranteed $2.5 million in what was simply termed the fight. For one brief moment in history, two boxers commanded the world's attention. The Battle of Champions lived up to its billing.
That's what you do, a man like Joe Frazier. Back off of him, just keep boxing.
He will be easier to hit. He will not be as much trouble or as awkward as Oscar Bonavino. Joe Frazier,
I mean, this is the day, man.
About the day.
I just whooped
Bonavino. You're not fighting Quarry, you're not fighting Oscar Bonavino, you're not fighting Sonny Liston, you fighting Joe Frazier.
Joe Frazier. If Joe Frazier whoops me, I'm getting on my hands and my knees, all across the ring, look up to you, say,
I'm trying to get you on the spot.
Ali trying to tie Joe Frazier up in close.
Joe wants to punch in there. Ali tells Frazier that didn't hurt. Ali talking to Joe Frazier. The fans cheering for their man, Muhammad Ali, as Joe pours it on. Ali seems disdainful in there. Both men ripping, tearing, bombing punches at each other. This is what the crowd came to see. Ali tells Joe, come on back. And come back he does. Joe Frazier lands the best punch of the fight. Ali almost goes down. Ali in desperate trouble. Ali holding on. Frazier trying to end it here in round 11. Can Ali last the round out? Frazier shoves Muhammad Ali off of him. It's all Joe Frazier. Another torrid left hook by champion Joe Frazier. Ali can hardly stand. Muhammad Ali, rubbery leg, obviously in desperate trouble here in the 11th round, and there's the bell. Here in the 15th and last round, it's still very close. An explosive left to the jaw, and Muhammad Ali goes down. Ali is up at the count of three. Arthur Mercanni wipes off the gloves, and Joe Frazier moves in to finish it.
Joe Frazier won a 15-round unanimous decision, but he spent several days in the hospital recuperating from the battle. Ali's jaw was swollen to melon size, requiring a doctor's care. Both fighters brought the best out of the other. Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier, a classic rivalry. After Ali beat Frazier in a second non-title fight, Ali won the heavyweight crown from George Foreman. His fourth defense was on October 1st, 1975. The world anticipated yet another brutal war between Ali and Frazier. What transpired was one of the greatest fights in heavyweight history.
And in one of the sharp poems, it says there will be a killer and a thriller and a chiller when I get the gorilla in Manila.
That's right. And I got his conscience right here to keep me on guard. See, here's the way he looks when you hit it. All night, that's all he's gonna be. All night in Malaysia. That's all you're gonna see. The Philippines, rather. Come on, gorilla. We in Manila. Come on, gorilla. This is a thriller.
World heavyweight champion Muhammad Ali takes on his redoubtable nemesis, Smokin' Joe Frazier, for the third time.
The champion in white trunks is ahead on points, but Joe in blue is starting to come on strong. Torrid punches to the body and head by former champ Smokin' Joe Frazier. Joe would love to regain the heavyweight crown. Here in the 14th round, it's still very close. A torrent of blistering punches staggers the former champion. Joe Frazier in trouble here in the 14th round. Ali throwing bombs at Frazier. The champion is going for a knockout right here.
Frazier could not answer the bell for the 15th round. Ali later said the fight was like death, the closest thing to dying that I know of. I bring out the best in every man I fight, but Joe Frazier, I'll tell the world right now, brings out the best in me. It was the final act of a three-part drama which began 4 years earlier in Madison Square Garden. Many felt the third fight was the greatest performance in the history of boxing. Two heavyweights of incomparable courage, determination, and skill. Muhammad Ali and Joe Frazier.
It might have been the greatest fight of all time, the thrill in Manila. Muhammad, you said after that fight it was the closest thing to dying. What are your recollections now, 7 years later?
The reason I made that statement, I was so tired, so exhausted, so weak, I barely could walk out of the ring. And they had to carry out, and I was so down. So I said that this is next to death. The only thing that could have been worse was dying.
If it was next to death for the winner, Joe, what was it for you?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, I don't feel no different from that 75 now. I imagine that we all grow a little older. There's no doubt about that. But the body is still in condition to do things that necessary, whatever it is, you know, I take a part of it. He sleeps anyhow, so it don't make no difference. Yeah. That's probably why he's sleeping out. I'm left hook's got him sleeping. Yeah, he can't wake up right away.
Let me ask you what you're feeling.
His mind.
What are your feelings about each other now? You seem to have a great respect for each other. Now that the hype is all over, you don't have to sell tickets anymore.
Well, I always respect him, let's say, as a champion and as a man, you know, his way of living is his way and my way of living is mine. So therefore, I don't have anything against that. I would never, with him, you always got to be on your toe. You always got to watch him. When you walk away from him, walk backwards, not forward. Don't turn your back.
That's you.
That's you.
You gotta watch.
I gotta watch you. That's what I didn't say nobody's out.
All right, we're all gonna watch each other then. For Muhammad Ali and for Joe Frazier, two champions. There are no losers in this room, I will tell you that. Present company perhaps accepted. And for Larry Merchant, I'm Barry Tompkins. We'll see you next time on Boxing's Best. Thanks for joining us.
Okay. All right.